Krishma Neal with the Journal of Clinical Investigation. I'd like to welcome you to the next in our series of Conversations with Giants in Medicine. Today we're joined by Dr. Donald Seldin from the University of Texas Southwestern Medical Center in Dallas. Dr. Seldin served as the Chairman of Medicine at UT Southwestern for nearly four decades and transformed the department and the school from a grouping of ramshackle army barracks into a world-class medical center host to Nobel Laureates and members of the National Academies. He was also a major figure in the emergence of nephrology as a legitimate discipline, and in this role he was one of the founders of the American Society for Nephrology and served as its second president. Among his many attributes, Seldin has been described as one of the most magnetic and charismatic mentors in academic medicine that anyone has encountered. We look forward to hearing a lot about his career in medicine. Can you start by telling me a little bit about your background and what your path was to medical school?
Well, initially, I was not interested in medicine. I was interested in philosophy and literature, particularly poetry. But I grew up in the midst of the Depression, which was particularly serious in New York. I had to think of ways to earn a living following graduation. And friends of mine who were studying philosophy and literature and so forth were in terrible straits because of the financial crisis. So I tried to think of some other discipline where I might go, which would be of interest to me, where I could forge a reasonable career, and I thought medicine would be exciting. So in the latter part of my career at NYU, I took a number of science courses so as to qualify for application to medical school. And I applied to a number of medical schools and was accepted at Yale, where I went.
Now, when you were at Yale, how did your interest in laboratory science develop?
Well, Yale was a very interesting school at the time. At NYU, we used to have examinations daily, then surprise examinations weekly, then examinations monthly, exams with the rule of the day. Mm-hmm. When I came to Yale, there were, pardon me, only about 49 students in a class. There were no exams for 2 years. Attendance was not taken, and you could come or not as you pleased. This kind of laissez-faire program was at first startling to me, but sooner or later I became very much attracted to it. It allowed me to read where I wanted to go, to explore things outside the standard curriculum. And when I entered the third year in medicine, I was very attracted to John Peters. He was the head of the metabolic section, one of the towering figures of American medicine. And I began to do research in the third year while I was taking my clinical clerkship.
And did you start working in his lab? How did you decide on the project that you were going to start doing your research?
Well, the project could be anything one wanted to choose upon, and I chose to examine diabetic acidosis. We had patients in abundance. This department had a long history of studying diabetes and acidosis, and it seemed to me an exciting area. So a colleague of mine and I embarked on a study of patients with diabetic acidosis, exploring glucose and electrolyte metabolism in this disorder.
Now, after your medical training, you served as a captain in the army, correct, in Germany? Can you tell us a little bit about what that experience was like?
Well, I was assigned to the medical service at Munich, Germany. And in the course of my service, I was summoned to a trial at Dachau, a concentration camp some 30 or 40 miles outside Munich. There, a Nazi medical officer was on trial for having been associated with the death of some 30 or 40 inmates previously. I was summoned as an expert witness. My role was to testify to the status of liver biopsy at that time and shortly before that during the war. Apparently, these patients, inmates of Dachau, had died following liver biopsies. And the question the court raised, this was a military court, was whether liver biopsy was justified in terms of, one, informed consent, two, whether liver biopsy was indicated for therapeutic or prognostic purposes. And I was asked to testify about these matters. And I indicated briefly at the time that liver biopsy at that time, which had been developed by Koch in Chicago and others, was an experimental procedure that presumably informed consent would be necessary, and that at that time the therapeutic or prognostic information that would be forthcoming would be trivial. Liver biopsy was not an important guide to therapy at the time. In fact, there was very little in the way of therapy. So the trial proceeded by the Nazi medical officer challenging my status as an expert witness. And he apparently was very well educated. He had had a fellowship at the Rockefeller Institute, as I recall, and he was associated with the liver biopsies which had been followed by the death of these inmates. So he asked me what I knew about the status of liver biopsy in 1943 in Germany, and I told him very little. In Paris, nothing. Mm-hmm. In Prague, nothing. So he challenged my expertise in commenting on liver biopsy in view of the fact that no information was forthcoming for these areas. I pointed out that liver biopsy had been developed largely in the United States, that the advances in liver biopsy were at the forefront there, and that one could infer from what was known about liver biopsy that to date it had no therapeutic implications. The officer proceeded to open a huge book, which I think was Peterson Vance Like Methods, and began to ask me a series of questions. How do you fractionate the plasma protein? How do you do a BSP? And he wanted to probe the details of these methods, not the general overall scope. This would be very difficult for an ordinary physician to cope with.
But you had just been doing these experiments.
It so happens that at Yale, where I was a student fellow, you had to go through the methods of the department personally. And in Munich, I was responsible for setting up the clinical laboratory. So I was able to cope with these questions reasonably well. And after a day and a half, the judges decided that enough had been explored and that my qualifications were reasonable, and the trial proceeded.
And based on your expert testimony, what happened?
Well, they were convicted and sentenced to death. This was an army court. Three generals were in charge, and I must say, as far as I could see, the proceedings were very fair. The officer was offered an American counsel but refused and functioned as his own lawyer.
After your time in Germany, I remember reading from your biography, you weren't exactly sure what you were going to do next, but there was a letter from Peters inviting you to come back to Yale. Did you return there mostly to do scientific work, or did you think that it was going to be more of a clinical position?
Well, the letter was very brief. It was almost the last day I was in Germany. By accident, I went back to the hospital to check the mail, and there was a letter from Dr. Peters, which was of two sentences. I would like to offer you a position as instructor in medicine at Yale at a salary to begin at $2,500 a year. And the second sentence was, why haven't you written? Check. So with this in hand, and I was sort of surprised and exhilarated, I came back to the United States, and we went to New Haven.
So how did you end up getting recruited to UT Southwestern, and what did you make of the place when you first arrived?
Well, I was very happy at Yale, but you must remember that at that time there were very few medical schools of a high academic type in the United States. Medical schools were just being developed all over the country, but they were new. One of the older and more established schools was Yale, and the section in the Department of Medicine where I was in was very crowded. Almost the entire Department of Medicine consisted of the metabolic division. I was very happy there. They treated me very well, but it was a crowded place. And when I received an offer from Dr. Burnett, Charles Burnett, who had just accepted an appointment as chairman at Southwestern, I decided to take it. I was very naive at the time. I never looked at the institution. I never visited. And when I came to Dallas, it was quite a shock.
I read from your biography that you turned up to the corner that they had indicated and you weren't sure whether or not that was actually what the school
was. When I arrived in Dallas in my car, accompanied by my daughter and my wife, I inquired at a filling station where the medical school was because I wanted to see it. I hadn't visited before. And I drove down where he indicated, and all I saw was a bunch of broken down shacks and garbage. So I thought that I had missed the school, and I returned to the filling station and indicated to the attendant that I went where he instructed me, but all I saw was garbage and shacks. And he said, that's it. It's the medical school.
Did you regret the choice at that point, or did you consider it a challenge?
Life be what it is, I nodded, and we went to an overnight hotel to face the future.
Now, you were promoted to the chairman of the department at a very early age. Was there much resistance that you encountered to that?
Well, I had encountered a certain amount of opposition. I understand that. I was from the Northeast, and I had a view of medical education which was somewhat different from that which had prevailed at the school. And when I was asked to assume the chair, there was obviously some people who were enthusiastic, but some who thought this was a tragedy.
But you took it on with aplomb and apparently really transformed the way that medical education, at least at UT Southwestern, was taught. Now, did you base that on the Yale model where there were not quite as many exams and the students were given a little bit more liberty?
Well, first of all, in Dallas at that time, lectures were given interminably. This was the main avenue of instruction, and the lectures were of a heterogeneous type. The student might be on medicine and have urology or dermatology or whatnot lectures given, but the lectures weren't geared to the clinical activities. So what I tried to do was to set up a block system where a student assigned to medicine would be the responsibility of the Department of Medicine. Emphasis was placed on the clinical clerkship. and lectures were geared. They were reduced in number drastically and were geared to elucidate the clinical problems in medicine. And they were physiologically oriented to a great extent. And by and large, I think it worked out well.
Right. Now, did you do much of the teaching yourself?
Oh, yes. There was, well, Dallas was a complicated place at the time. The chairman of medicine was Charles Burnett. I was not the chairman. I came down as an associate professor of medicine. Within a year of my appearing, I came to Dr. Burnett's office to tell him that a paper of mine had been accepted for presentation at Atlantic City, not Washington, Atlantic City, at the Steel Pier. This was a towering thing at the time. And he told me that he thought that was great. He congratulated me and indicated that he was considering going to the University of North Carolina. He had only been in Dallas 6 to 8 months. Within 2 or 3 months, he was left. He left for North Carolina, and the Department of Medicine consisted of one full-time faculty member.
You?
Me.
Right.
And in a short period of time, the professor of obstetrics, Dr. Mengert, left for Chicago. Gil Forbes, the chairman of pediatrics, left for Rochester. Carl Moyer, the chairman of surgery, left for Washington University of St. Louis. And I remained as the sole and solitary chairman amongst the clinical services.
So you had to do all of the teaching then, essentially.
Well, I had to do a lot of the teaching of medicine. But we had great support from the community. In other words, the clinical faculty, the physicians in town, assumed a great deal of responsibility in helping with ward rounds and other activities. So we managed, and I tried to slowly develop a program.
Right. But in those early days, you had to do a lot of recruiting. Who did you manage to?
Recruiting couldn't be done broadly because there was very little money available, and the space was trivial and broken down. The people I worked with mainly were medical students. It turned out that medical students were magical. We had Floyd Rector, who later became a major figure in electrolyte metabolism, Gene Wilson, who became a major figure in cholesterol and sexual development, Dan Forster, Jerry Mitchell, and many others. These were all medical students. And most of them worked with me, and then I sent them away for training, largely to the National Institutes of Health. They came back, and they constituted the core of the faculty. And after time, we were able to flesh out various disciplines. For example, I wanted a gastroenterologist. I talked to various people on a study section I was at, and the consensus was it was hard to get a gastroenterologist of academic caliber at that time, but I should send a fellow. I sent John Fortran, who was one of my residents, who had never heard of gastroenterology. I sent him to Boston to work with Franz Engelfinger. He took a fellowship there, returned, and developed the program. And in a number of other instances, I was able to do the same thing, sending fellows away, student fellows, and bringing them back in various disciplines.
Well, that brings me to my next question. Really, pretty much everyone who I spoke to about you and about your role at UT Southwestern commented about how magnetic you were, and that you were a bit of a boomerang. You would send your students off to get training elsewhere, but you managed to ensnare them to come back. I mean, what did you do in order to keep such talent?
Well, of course, I knew them well. See, I was making rounds all the time. I knew the students on a personal basis. And when I sent them away, I tried to indicate that I would want them to come back on the faculty, and fortunately, most of them did. The longest departure was Joe Goldstein. That's a few years later. Joe started out interested in neurosurgery, but I told him that it would be better if he went into metabolism or molecular biology. And I was very anxious to develop a program in genetics. At that time, there were very few departments of clinical genetics in the United States. So I wanted him to go away for training and then come back and develop a genetics program. For 2 years, he went to the Massachusetts General Hospital for house officer training. 2 years beyond that, he studied at the National Institutes of Health with Marshall Nirenberg. And then for 2 years beyond that, he studied in genetics in Seattle. All told, he was away for 6 years. And during that time, he had published really very formidable papers on lipids and their relation to heart disease, and had received a number of offers. But he was very loyal. He returned to Dallas and developed a program, and fortunately went on to win a Nobel Prize with his colleague Mike Brown.
Right. Now, all these people that claim that you were, the most meaningful mentor to them, what sort of advice do you have to your colleagues about being a good mentor?
Well, I, it's hard to say whether there's a formula or some program, but obviously you want to have intimate relations with the student or the fellow. You would hope that the individual would apply, would aid in the development of basic problems, and you would want to ensure that their training was solid. This might include going away for special training in a basic science department and coming back, or it may all be done at the same institution. But it would require close supervision and a good deal of support. These days, I think the greatest need, in my view anyway, is on a clinical level. Clinical physiology and clinical medicine really require support in the development of academic research programs in a setting where the demands of clinical care are very high.
Right. Now, you already talked about some of the people who you trained: Jean Wilson, Joe Goldstein, Dan Foster, etc. Another one was Robert Cade, who trained with you, went away but stayed away, and part of what he did was go to the university floor and develop Gatorade. But did he learn about electrolyte balance from you?
Robert Cade was an offbeat fellow. He would have all sorts of ideas, like dialysis for schizophrenia and the like. He worked with me and with the renal unit on salt and water metabolism, and then left to work with Robert Pitts at Cornell in electrolyte and water. And finally went to Florida, where he's on the faculty, and developed Gatorade. He also developed a helmet with a gel in it so that blows on the head would be appropriately resisted and demonstrated it by hammering his head with the helmet on it with a baseball bat, indicating that it worked.
Now, on the sort of theme of mentoring and your former students, do you have any advice to, you know, the people who are watching this interview, especially young trainees, about how to succeed, and especially clinical department of medicine, and trying to make sure that they remain physician scientists?
Well, this is a complicated time. The demands for clinical service are very high. They compete with the time available for academic work. It would be very advisable if one wanted a career in the academic programs of medicine to ensure that sufficient time and resources were available that were protected sufficiently to allow one to do research. And at the same time, to be in an institution where the atmosphere supported and encouraged inquiry and theory and the way to physiologically analyze disease. To choose an appropriate institution as a housing for your academic career is important, I would think. And at the same time, you would want a mentor who was interested in advancing the program. And if you ask about a clinical fellowship, you're talking about the problem of protecting time so that it's available to do a research program, hopefully linked in some manner with exploration of disease.
The mentors that you named, John Peters, etc., you know, the people who you were with at Yale, what did they teach you about being a mentor that you think helped?
Well, Peters was a man of unimpeachable integrity. He was a very deep scholar, very, very well-read, very critical, and very dedicated to academic work. But at the same time, he never neglected his clinical responsibilities and tried very hard to exploit his clinical experience for academic purposes. At the same time, he was extremely moral, a man of the highest academic and social ideals, very anxious to ensure that the best of medicine reached all the people. And for this reason, he was in the center of a great deal of controversy when I was at Yale. This was during the McCarthy administration, and he was fired from the study section on grounds that he was a security risk.
And did that materially impact his career or your view of him?
Well, the case came before the Supreme Court. The judgment was set aside, but the constitutional issue of whether he was a security risk was not settled. The court simply ruled that there was a technical error in his charge and therefore set aside the ruling. He continued at Yale for the rest of his career. But he was a gigantic influence, and his example, not specific instructions, but his example, what he did, how he functioned, was an inspiration to all his students.
Right. Now, I've heard that you don't use cell phones or the internet, and that you've sort of resisted some of these things. How do you manage to keep up when there's so much media and information being thrown at us all?
Well, you know, it's possible to read. And I like to read, and I like to study, and it's not difficult to keep up.
Fantastic. Now, you went recently to Madrid and Venice, and I hear that Harry's Bar is one of your favorite places.
Well, I like Venice, among other Italian cities, because I'm very interested in art, archaeology, and the like. I'm particularly interested in Romanesque art. and other forms of art, and Renaissance art as well. I like to go to the school of San Rocco and see the Tintorettos and other art in the academy. And I like to visit the churches and see the art of the past. I like to go to Harry's Bar, particularly at New Year's Eve. We were there last year, where they have a big party and dancing, and we had a good time, and we could wander through the canals and churches, enjoy the rich background of Renaissance and medieval art. The rest of Italy is pretty good too.
Right. Now, given all of these proclivities to studying and being interested in art and travel, what do you think that you would have done if you were not a scientist or a doctor? Would you have followed those sorts of passions?
Well, I mentioned earlier that my principal interest before medicine was in philosophy and literature, particularly poetry. And I would have tried, had circumstances been different, to develop a career in those areas, presumably in a university.
Right. Well, you have certainly a way with words. I'm going to consult my notes here on the celebration of your tenure in your department. Some of your students put together some of your more classic witticisms, where some of the, just a few of the amusing ones are, education is what you have left after you've forgotten the fact. And when you said something about surgery, does your mother know that you are cutting people open for a living? And I think my favorite of some of your writings, this is a beautiful example of therapeutic frenzy combined with abysmal ignorance. Where did you develop this way of talking?
Well, it's not anything special. These were more offhand remarks. But I like the language, and I like the issues of formulating things in a coherent way.
Well, and also in a witty way that certainly gets the point across.
Well, that helps too.
Well, thank you very much for joining us today. We've really enjoyed hearing about your path through medicine.
Pleasure.
Thank you.